Bonjour à tous, nous allons commencer cette session qui va traiter un problème, un point chaud, un hotspot sur la carte internationale et sur la carte des conflits internationaux. Elle va être en anglais, nous allons assurer cette session en anglais et je vais vous présenter dans un instant nos distingués orateurs. So we are going to hold the session in English, and Jean-Luc and I will make a great effort in switching from our French mother language to English, and to have the most insightful comment from our distinguished speaker today. Firstly, I want to mention that the Kashmiri issue is a very complex and hot issue today. It's been a conflict lasting from the decolonization of South Asia by the British in 1947. And I would like to comment more on this issue and to give you an historical background on that with our first distinguished speaker, which is a seasoned diplomat. He's been ambassador in Russia, in Netherlands, in Sweden. He's been also deputy minister for foreign affairs of his country, Pakistan. And Mustafa Kamal Kazi, could you give us a brief outlook on the historical background and where are we today on the Kashmiri issue, which is the most pressing issue in South Asia at the time being?
First of all, I would like to I like to compliment organizers of MeDays for including discussion on security and stability in South Asia, which has been subject of heightened concern, particularly in the recent past. South Asia is one of the most significant geopolitical region in the world. This is geographically contiguous to Central Asia, Middle East, East Asia, and rising global giant China. So we are very strategically located, this entire region of South Asia. It covers less than 4% of world's landmass, but is home to nearly 2 billion people, representing 23% of world population. So we are nearly quarter of global population. So what happens in that region affects the destiny of rest of the world as well. How unfortunately, despite of its strategic location, and enormous economic potential, South Asia has not been able to emerge as an effective regional bloc and make use of multifaceted scope and opportunities to achieve economic growth and regional connectivity. Before the colonization of South Asia by British, just three countries in the region, Pakistan, India, and Bangladesh, contributed 25% of global GDP. So the area has enormous historical potential economically. But unfortunately, when the British left, we were just on the ground, as it is for most colonial countries, and we were nowhere. Now, thanks to China's emergence as a global economic giant, we have a tremendous opportunity. The region has tremendous opportunity by way of Road and Belt program, which is $1 trillion estimated, spread in various parts of the world, and of which Pakistan-China corridor is a flagship project. And the worth of Pakistan-China economic corridor is more than $16 billion. And it is very fast on way its implementation with infrastructure, road, rail, lot of connectivity. The only country in the world which has opted out of both road and belt, as well as Pakistan-China corridor, is our neighboring India. This gives idea of the mindset that prevails. Now, Pakistan's geographical location is such that it links South Asia with energy-rich West Asia and Central Asia, without which South Asia has no connectivity at all, west of South Asia. It's Pakistan. Now, with Pakistan, we have this issue of Kashmir, which has been there for the last 72, 73 years, a colonial legacy, and under 11 UN Security Council resolutions, also bilateral agreement between India and Pakistan, which both the UN Security Council resolutions as well as bilateral agreement between India and Pakistan of 1972, what's called Simla Accord, requires both countries not to change the status quo pending the solution of the Kashmir issue. Now, what has happened in the last 3 months that Kashmir has been dissolved as an entity. It has been partitioned, broken into pieces, two pieces, both, and lost its statehood, status as the only Muslim majority state in India, has become a union territory. You know, now that is the lowest grade that, I mean, any federal agency or entity can have in India. And to implement this horrendous decision, it's now 103 or 4 days that the Kashmiri, 9 million Kashmiris are locked. They can't get out, the children can't go to school, they can't go to the marketplaces. There's no internet connectivity, except on very selected basis to those whom the government regards as safe people or approved people. Obviously, these 9 million people are, you know, to take care of these 9 million people, there is presence of 900,000 Indian soldiers. So there's one soldier for every 8 Kashmiri. This is the largest military presence in any occupied area. You know. And this happens when India had 72 years to win the heart and minds of Kashmiris. 72 years of possession of people. You know, it's a great thing. You have the great opportunity. But this is the result of the goodwill that should have been cultivated to win the population, who already have very serious reservations. Now, why it has happened in past, there have been many governments in India, both the BJP, the present ruling party, as well as the Congress party, and right. But none of them have dared to go that far. If the latest maps that have been released officially by India do not have even abolished the line of control, because as you know, Kashmir is divided between Pakistan, India, and what Indians call the Chinese part of the Aksai Chin, which is Aksai Chin, I mean, bordering Kashmir, but India claims to be part of Kashmir. You know. Now, Kashmir is, therefore, a very dangerous global flashpoint, as it involves not only two nuclear powers, India and Pakistan, but also third one, that is China, three nuclear powers, and population of more than half of the global population. If you add Chinese population to the South Asian population, it becomes half, nearly half. Either a person has to be fooled to disregard those realities, or crazy. Of course, these times we are living in, times where there's no dearth of mentally deranged leadership in the world, basically. So probably we have that there. And I leave it to my colleague to give you the ideological moorings behind which are propelling the present leadership in India to go and defy to that extent that it is costing them economically. India's growth was 7% plus just about a year back. Today, it is driven down to 5%. And probably it will go further down. The other thing is, how do you treat your minorities? Now, India is a huge country, gigantic country, with a population of 1.3 billion, of which 200 million are just Muslim minority. And Christians, Sikhs, and Dalits, the underdog, the untouchable class in India. Now, here is a government which is in a virtual battle with its minorities. You can't, if somebody is suspected to have eaten beef or has, he is totally, there's a mob rule, which are dealing on its own, and the government sits quietly to see the street takes its own course, So it's a very dangerous situation, and it's not only a question of solving the Kashmir issue today. It has remained as an issue for last 73 years, but it's a question of the fate and destiny of the Kashmiri people, their human rights, their sufferings, the torture. 13-year-old kids are being taken in police custody, school kids, minors, and driven to areas, far off places in India in custody, and parents don't know where they are. And people can't get out of their houses because there's so many soldiers around, and the soldiers are not very disciplined as it is. So I think the question that is of immediate concern, which the world community has to deal with it, both at the government as well as the popular level, is the situation of the 9 million Kashmiris who are imprisoned in their own land against their wishes. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mustafa, because you've been giving the audience also another view of the situation from a geostrategical point of view, but also from a view from the ground and what's happening on the ground and for the people of Kashmir. But you've been mentioning that three nuclear power are involved in that crisis, from which one of them is represented in this panel. I'm not asking to Professor Jean Krasin to make the advocate of other power in the region, maybe could bring us some insight of how the other side of the frontier is looking at the situation and planting what is your take, Jean-Luc, on the situation and the competing narrative that are given on the situation?
Yeah, well, thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation. Yes, of course, I'm in a pretty difficult position because, as you know, we are here Pakistani expert, but no Indian expert. But of course, as a French academic, I'm not supposed to be the spokesperson of the Indian government, but as an academic, I'll try to offer a kind of balanced view, but you know, it's very difficult to be recognized as balanced in such a type of geopolitical conflict, because the relationship between India and Pakistan, and at the core of it, it's not the only issue, but at the core of it, the question of Kashmir is for me the kind of perfect example of intractable geopolitical opposition between two post-colonial power. And one of the way to look at it is to recognize that, but it's classic, I shall comment on that in a minute, but to recognize that even the reading of history differs between New Delhi and Islamabad. Ambassador has rightly mentioned that it's a post-colonial legacy. You know, if we turn to the United Nations Security Council resolution, there are three issues which have been on the agenda since the very beginning, the end of the 1940s and the beginning of the 1950s. One is Korea, South Korea, North Korea. The other is what was called by the UN India-Pakistan, but which is basically on the issue on Kashmir. And the third one is Israel-Palestine. So out of the three, two of them, Israel-Palestine and India-Pakistan, are a legacy of a difficult post-colonial past, due, of course, to the decision of the British to leave their space. And what's important to have in mind is what happened just after the decision of the British to leave. And here again, there is different reading of history. For the Indian side, they refer to what was the rationale of the partition, where you differ between the land which were under direct control of the British and the land which were in the hand of the princes, the Maharaja, the Nizam, or whatever. According to the rule of the game, the princes of the king, of the Rajas, had to choose between India and Pakistan. For most of them, when they were enclaves in the new state of India and Pakistan, there was no real choice. But for the Maharaja of Kashmir, which was one of the biggest princely states, Kashmir was just between India and Pakistan. So the Maharaja, who was an Hindu ruler of a state with a Muslim majority, who had to face an opposition even before the time of independence, try to remain independent, which was not possible, try, as you mentioned, Mr. Ambassador, to have a kind of standstill agreement, so let's see, trying to make the best of the situation. But finally, he decided to accede to India because he was subject to the pressure, not to say to the invasion, of tribal militia coming basically from the tribal areas from Pakistan, close to the border of Afghanistan. And here it is seen by the Pakistani side as being volunteers going for some sort of jihad for the Kashmiri brother against the Indian state, but which is seen by the Indian are being militia backed by the new established state power in Pakistan, with some Pakistani military officer, not in uniform, provided guidance to those militias. So, seen from New Delhi, as the Maharaja decided to protect himself from these invaders, to accede to India, for India, all Kashmir, including what was mentioned, the Trans-Himalaya plateau of Aceh Chin, which has been controlled by China in the 1950s, for India, all Kashmir is earth. The Pakistani position is different. They do consider that all Kashmir is a contested area. The problem is that after the invasion from militia trying to reach Srinagar, where the Maharaja was sitting, there was a real war between the two countries. I mean, the military were involved. And the UN got a kind of ceasefire on the 1st of January 1949. And the line of ceasefire during a second war, short war between India and Pakistan in 65, and a third one in 71, became the line of control. So, south of the line of control, the state of Jammu and Kashmir was India administered, but with full apparatus of an Indian state, which means an elected assembly and representative to the parliament in New Delhi. On the other side, the Pakistani administered area has been divided in two. Close to Srinagar, there was what's called Azad Kashmir, so the Kashmir free, which is a kind of state without international recognition, with a president, an assembly, a prime minister, etc. But nothing can really be done if there is no agreement from Islamabad. And north of the line of control is a large territory called Gilgit-Baltistan, which does not enjoy ever a statue of being a kind of semi-autonomous state or a full-fledged Pakistani province. Why? Because if Pakistan was decided to give to Gilgit-Baltistan the status of a province, and this is something which is debated upon for the last few years, it would mean by implication that Pakistan would no more consider that Kashmir is a contested territory. So you have a kind of paradox where on the Indian side, you have a political class who is playing the parliamentary game or the election game and who are pro-India, and you have, since the early 90s, a sizable part of the population which is against India and who revolted in 1991. The revolt was more or less in a difficult time after 2-3 years, and from 93 to 94, the Pakistan decided to support the Kashmiri insurgent and send some jihadi groups, the most best known today, the name has changed eventually, were the Lashkar-e-Taiba and the Jaish-e-Mohammed. We are so basically in a kind of intractable situation, which has changed for a part on August 5th of this year, because a part of a deal of what has been decided between the Maharaja and the Indian government was that, yes, Kashmir will join India, but keeping a large range of autonomy. And this autonomy has been shortened or degraded year after year, basically by the local elected assembly. But the last important remain of this autonomy has been made disappeared by the decision of the Indian government on August 5. The pretext was to say, well, the Indian argument, and I'm just giving you the Indian argument, is just to say, you know, there is terrorism, there is cross-border terrorism, and the autonomy is, in a way, preventing us to be fully efficient, one. And two, we want to integrate fully Kashmir for its development, which is a point which is debated in India itself, because on a number of issues, the Human Development Index is as good in Kashmir as on the other end. So I shall just end in saying that the case of one who is the genuine ruler of Kashmir, and two, what is the validity of the question of self-determination? Pakistan is constantly referring to the UN resolution of the 1940s and 50s about that. But the UN resolution, and I stop with that, first, are mainly recommendations. When you read them clearly, it's the UN Security Council recommend, do suggest that, etc. They made some committees and commission without result. But amongst the principle was that for having a referendum or a plebiscite, as we say in South Asia, on Kashmir, the Pakistani military must first leave the territory under the occupation, under Pakistani control. So it's intractable, and the decision of India to erase the last remnant of autonomy of the state of Jammu and Kashmir within the Indian Republic has only added to the tension between India and Pakistan during the last few months.
Thank you so much, Jean-Luc Racine, for giving us more context and the complexity of this question. And I want to turn on toward Shahrul Malik, which is an associate research associate in the Institute for Strategic Studies on Islamabad. And this removal of the autonomous status, as Jean-Luc said, is also a big, in French, we would say, a big un coup de canif dans le contrat, a blow to the former agreement between Kashmiri Authority and Maharaja and India. And also, it's something that has destroyed the status quo from 72 between India and Pakistan. And it's been a long on the program of the Nationalist Party of India, which is today ruling India. And could you tell us more on the BJP and the BJP program, on this what seems to be a rise of nationalism in India in that context?
Thank you. So, as you all know, that BJP is a right-wing party, and its policy has historically reflected Hindu nationalist positions. It has close ideological and organizational links with RSS. The far-right and Hindu nationalist BJP government in India is pursuing an extremist Hindutva approach and is transforming a once secular India into a Hindu majoritarian state, where the space for minorities and people with diverse views is shrinking very rapidly. BJP is seen actively promoting the Hindutva ideology of RSS and further marginalizing the minorities of India, which includes 200 million Muslims. And I would like to note here that the Muslim community is the third largest community in the world in India. And then we have Christians and Dalits as well. So the Hindu extremist groups with links to BJP are actively involved in exposing religious minorities to beef lynching and forceful Hindu conversion to Hinduism. Anyone that criticizes the BJP government or the government's decision is termed as anti-national. Sedition cases have been launched against numerous progressive scholars, writers, film directors as well, and students, only because they questioned the decisions of BJP and Prime Minister Modi. The BJP party has pushed to deny citizenship to Muslim immigrants in Assam who have long resided there for two decades now. It has also changed the names of the cities that were named after Muslim rulers, such as Allahabad, to Prayagraj. Recently, the Indian Supreme Court decided the controversial Babri Masjid or Ram Janmabhoomi case in favor of the Hindu community. This masjid is located in Ayodhya, and a Hindu mob tore down the 16th century mosque in 1992. Hindu activists believe that the mosque has been built on top of a temple that had stood on the precise birthplace for an important Hindu deity, Ram. It is very ironic that on the same day when the Indian Supreme Court passed this decision, Prime Minister Imran Khan was opening the doors of Pakistan to Kartarpur Corridor, which allowed visa-free access to Sikhs from all across the world, including India, to come and visit the shrine of Guru Baba Nanak on its 55th birth anniversary. So moving on, in an attempt by BJP government of establishing Akhand Bharat, which means actually an undivided India, Prime Minister Modi's government has stripped away the autonomy of Jammu and Kashmir, which is India's only Muslim majority state. Similarly, the abrogation of Article 370 and 35A by Modi is the fulfillment of a long ideological yearning under the Hindutva ideology promoted by the RSS to make a predominantly Muslim population surrender to its vision of a homogeneous Hindu nation. On August 5, the Indian government revoked Jammu and Kashmir's special status that was embedded in the Article 370 of the Indian Constitution, and it bifurcated the state into two union territories, one Jammu and Kashmir and the other one Ladakh. By revoking Article 370 and 35A of the Indian Constitution, Modi's government stripped the Indian occupied Kashmir of its relative independence, and it has placed it under direct rule of the central government in Delhi. And in the lead up to the August 5, we saw that India has sent thousands of troops to the region, and where already more than 700,000 troops already existed, thus making it one of the most militarized region of the world, as Ambassador Qazi Saab has already stated. Then it has imposed a crippling curfew. The lockdown is going on, and it has been more than 100 days now. People cannot get to the hospital. They can't communicate with their loved ones or go to schools or work. The everyday life has been paralyzed. The economic activity is also being hampered. So all this has put India's secular credentials in question. And this action of August 5 has various dimensions. If you look at from the legal aspect, it is the direct violation of the international laws and the bilateral agreements that have been signed between India and Pakistan. Then India is intentionally changing the demographics of the region because under the Article 35A, Indians from rest of the country cannot purchase land in Kashmir. But since this has been abrogated, now they are allowed to do so. And now this is going to have a severe form of demographic repercussions and changes in the region. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Shaharu. I would take Mustafa comment on what is being discussed, and also after that, I would like also Jean-Luc to comment on the role of minority, considering minority as a key point of any agreements that could settle the situation in South Asia. And Mustafa, what is your take on what's being discussed on this political development in India, but also maybe in Pakistan? How this conflict also is driving the Pakistani politics today?
Well, Pakistan politics is, the very first day that our Prime Minister took oath of office, Prime Minister Imran Khan, he made this announcement, offered hand of friendship to India, and to meet, to talk, and to resolve our issues and have a dialogue. That was very promptly rejected. But then we still carried on, and this corridor that has been opened visa-free to the Indian nationals, they just can walk into that space and perform their religious rites. It's not only Sikhs, but also Hindus can come. I mean, it's free, anybody who comes, and visa-free. that was inaugurated just about 4 days back. We did not resign, so it shows the attitude. Of course, there can be incidents, stray incidents anywhere, and there have been. But on the whole, the state policy as a whole, is very sensitive to the minority rights in Pakistan. Minorities, religious minorities in Pakistan are very small percentage of the total population. Unlike in India, where the Muslim minority alone is equivalent to the population of Pakistan, near about, plus minus. Then there is Sikh, who have a very distinct identity of their own, have problems, seriously, as if you recall, when Mrs. Indira Gandhi was murdered, and it was a Sikh bodyguard who, assassinated her, in reaction to what happened at the Sikh temple in Punjab, Indian Punjab, settle an insurgency, the Golden Temple, very famous temple in India, in Punjab, Indian Punjab, was taken over, and sanctity violated, and the Sikh, in his emotional rage, he was the bodyguard, and he fired and killed. And after that incident, there were thousands and thousands of Sikhs killed. Similarly, when this 16th century mosque was demolished in 92 by this mob, led by the present Prime Minister of India. He was there. His pictures. He led this mob to demolish stone by stone this mosque, which is 500 years old. Babri Mosque. It's in to sanctify the entry of the second emperor, Mughal dynasty, Babur. So, this mosque was demolished. Then the day that we announced, as my colleague mentioned, that this opening of this corridor, visa-free corridor, for Sikh and Hindu pilgrims to come to Pakistan and, just walk into it. And the judgment of the Babri Mosque case in the Supreme Court was decided. Now, Supreme Court, we have this British traditions. There's a lot of, expectation of independence from the higher courts, And they have very often, both in India and Pakistan, in their judgments, gone against the incumbent governments. Many, many case examples. Here, the Supreme Court, in a decision, which is very incredible, it says that, this mosque has been existing for 500 years, although the Muslim community has not been able to produce documentary evidence, but the mosque has been there for 500 years. But now that this mosque has been demolished, so now the entire ground is to be given for construction of the temple. What kind of that? Because the mob, it's the endorsement of what mob did, This is the bizarre. And we are asking a 600-year established entity to the other side, you have failed to produce a title to your, ownership or, of the mosque, 500 years. The other point I want to actually clarify that at the time of independence, it was not only Kashmiri Maharaja involved in this difficult situation. He wanted both sides, India and Pakistan, to give him time. So he asked for a standstill agreement. Now, when India came to independence, it was a successor state to British. It had army, it had all paraphernalia of state. Pakistan was a entirely new entity, and devoid of army also, which was. Now, in this situation, then other issue that came up, drawing of the boundary line between India and Pakistan. The province of Punjab was split into two, and on the east, there was, and district-wise referendums were held. Referendums, or you could say, by where the district where there was a Muslim majority was to go to Pakistan, and where there was Hindu majority was to go to India. Now, what happened, there was one district that linked Kashmir geographically. That is that district was called Gurdaspur. Now, the Radcliffe Award gave Gurdaspur to India, giving it access to Kashmir. Otherwise, if Gurdaspur was part of Pakistan, there was no way that Indians could even move into Kashmir. So, you know, that created a lot of misgiving on the Pakistani side. And also, I mean, nervousness on the people. The tribal people that Professor mentioned, you know, these are the people who actually been the conquerors of India. I mean, you know, historically, Pathans, and, you know, if you see all these rulers of different Muslim states or Indian states, Muslim rulers, they were mostly from that area, from Afghanistan, from this part of Pakistan, which is called Pashtunistan, I mean, Khyber Pashtunistan. So the one thing. And then there were three states in this controversy, which side to go. One was Kashmir, as we talked about. Other was very large state, Hyderabad Deccan, you know, where the... where the ruler, was more interested in keeping his independence. And that was also an option that was open to him. But then Indian army invaded it. The majority was Hindu population, but he wanted to be independent, neither Pakistan nor India. And so it was invaded by the army. The Maharaja, the ruler of Nizam, who is called Nizam of Deccan, he was humiliated, he had to surrender. Then there was another state called Junagadh and Manohar. It is close to Gujarat. Hyderabad Deccan is on the south of India. And now Junagadh, though a Hindu majority, but the ruler was Muslim, he opted for Pakistan. But Pakistan did not insist on the, to carry out this accession. So we respected the, the wishes of the population. Then fourth point is that who went to United Nations Security Council? It was India, which took the issue of Kashmir to Security Council in a promise that this accession is not final. We will ascertain the wishes of Kashmiri people, and that is where it will be endorsed. So this was Prime Minister Nehru, who was a great leader. Yeah. Now, unfortunately, his memory is being obliterated by the current government. Mm-hmm. Even Mr. Gandhi's remains in an urn in a museum were stolen on the day when they celebrated 150th anniversary of Gandhi's birth. Yes. So that very day, and it was. And the person who is now being considered for a posthumous award is a person who is, of course, no more existing, was one of the person accused of involvement in Gandhi murder. And Gandhi was murdered by RSS activist, which is to which Mr. Modi belongs. So, you know, there are very strong... other point which is I wish to make is the tie-up. I mean, you know, the Hindu extremist who proclaimed that if you are an Indian citizen living in India, you, whatever religion you may have, you have to accept Hindutva, to be a Hindu, you know. And what else is your private affair? Then the Norwegian extremist who murdered 72 people in Norway, Anders Breivik, you know. Yeah. He had in his manifesto, more than 1,000-page manifesto, he has sympathized with the Indian, RSS and BJP extremists,
So you're saying there's a broader connection between nationalism and white supremacism?
White supremacist, Hindu nationalist, and Israeli Zionist. So this is a very dangerous, kind of a juggernaut, and the world has to be very mindful about these extremists. Muslims are blamed as extremists, but I think the new kind of extremism that is coming up is far more dangerous, and world will have to deal with it.
Okay. The organizer just told me that we get 5 minutes to wrap up the session. And I would like to go straight to the point and have a two-minute comment on ideas and solutions that could help the region to solve the issue. And you mentioned Israel-Palestine issue, and as long as religion is involved, it's getting more complicated also to solve the issue, because you speak about a political narrative differing from Pakistan to Kashmir to India, but also if religion's narrative are getting involved, it's going to be more complicated. What is your take on this, Jean-Luc? In 2 minutes, could you say to us if referendum motion is credible today, if there's any international mediator that could help to solve the issue, if the UN is relevant, where's the US also, which is a key ally of both Pakistan and ally, is the US looking at the region as it is needed today, or is it distracted by any other political advertisement issues? Jean-Luc,
in two minutes. Yes.
Sorry.
Well, to go straight to the point, I'm very skeptical about the possibility of a mediation. The Indian position, don't ask me if they believe that or not, but the Indian position is there is a precondition for the normalization of a relationship between India and Pakistan, is that you really address the problem of Lashkar-e-Taiba and the Jaish-e-Mohammed. Their leaders are just under house arrest. Sometimes they are free. Now there is this question of the Financial Action Task Force, which has put Pakistan on the gray list, not on the black list. It's linked to the financing of terrorism. So India will not accept, even if they change completely their line, the principle of an open mediation. You will not see an American president with a Pakistani president and an Indian prime minister at the White House. That doesn't mean when there is a crisis, there is no discrete suggestion or more ever from Washington, in a way perhaps from Beijing, because Beijing is, Beijing support Pakistan. But 2 months after August, Xi Jinping was just embracing Modi during his visit to India. So China does recognize now, which is something of a new perception, that India is an emerging power. India as an economic power has now, will overtaken both France and the United Kingdom. And this is something which is apparent also in the Arab world. Indian relationship with Saudi Arabia and with the Emirates are significantly improving. And except Turkey and Malaysia, no Muslim country has clearly taken aside most of the discourse, and it's the same discourse from the West about Kashmir, say, well, give back to the Kashmiri their normal life, and for the rest, manage between yourself. This is something significant, and this is something which has been difficult, of course, to admit for Pakistani, that the Muslim world was not responding as expected by the Prime Minister. But on that, you must not be surprised. I've not seen much support in Pakistan itself to the cause of Uyghur in Xinjiang. Yeah. So when a big power or an ascending power is making trouble at home, the international community is extremely careful. We may regret it, but that's what we call real politics.
Thank you, Jean-Luc. And Charu, if you could conclude in in 1 minute or so, have we to be optimistic? Are you optimistic about an issue, or how are you looking at a solution?
First of all, I think that the United Nations has the responsibility to ensure peaceful resolution of the Kashmir dispute according to the United Nations Security Council resolutions. And it should be noted that it should be according to the wishes of the Kashmiri people as well, who want self-determination. So they need to conduct a free and fair, impartial plebiscite in the region. The only way forward that I believe, because US has offered mediation, but India keeps on saying that it does not want that. India keeps on saying that Kashmir is a bilateral issue, but in fact it is a dispute which has the potential of escalating into a full-blown war, and maybe into a nuclear war even, which can threaten the peace and security of the not just the region, but of the whole world. So I think that the only way forward is through peace talks and dialogue, to revive the composite dialogue process once again. Open backdoor diplomacy channels, although I do not see that happening in the near future, but I think maybe after a year or two we can have that, we can see that happening, although the Kashmir corridor gives us some sort of hope.
Thank you, Sharu. Unfortunately, we are not taking any question for the audience because we are rushed by the organizer to conclude. Maybe a last word from Mustafa. How are you looking at the solution?
I think the world needs to facilitate and encourage both countries to move towards a peaceful solution. And the peaceful solution has been discussed bilaterally between India and Pakistan, and many, many options have been found. In 2008, just about 11 years from now, there was a solution that was worked out through back channels, backdoor diplomacy, which was kind of giving autonomy to both sides of Kashmir, the Pakistani-controlled Kashmir and Indian Kashmir, make the line of control sort of a soft so that people can interact with each other and trade with each other, have cultural and family relationships, and the both country, they will have their own autonomous kind of increased autonomous governance, and both countries will step a little aside so that they have eventually to determine their future. So this was a great option. But then,
so soft borders, softened borders, trust measure, and that's how you're looking, and between India and Pakistan is the main key points that could solve this, yeah, this rising tension.
Realistic solution, because both sides have very hard positions. So to create softness and ultimately to let the people determine what they want.
Thank you so much, Mustafa, for that last word. Merci beaucoup d'avoir suivi cette session. Et on va enchaîner sur la prochaine session. Je vous demanderai d'applaudir les experts qui ont pu partager, j'espère, beaucoup de choses avec vous. Merci encore.